A monster storm, almost 1,000 miles wide.
This is going to be a big and powerful storm.
With the destructive power of an atomic bomb. A natural disaster of extraordinary force strikes the northeast coast of the United States.
Don't mess with Mother Nature.
Never seen anything like this.
What's going on? I don't know what's going on. It's a hurricane.
You would never think this was happening in New York.
50 homes already have burned to the ground.
This is unbelievable, man.
I've never witnessed anything like this.
Oh, my God!
Unbelievable. I'm sorry.
Hey, Heather, it's Michelle. Hi. I don't know. I can't even, I don't even know what to say. I'm just happy that we're alive. We're all just sort of, there's no power, there's no service, there's no phones. It's like a scene out of some end of the world movie.
The people on the East Coast wake to Sandy's aftermath. This was a storm of almost unimaginable power. Sandy's impact was felt along the coastline from Florida to Massachusetts before she made landfall. Then it blew an ocean into the heart of New York City.
Oh my God!
With such devastating power, she grows to a superstorm.
Uh-oh.
Terrifying millions of people.
Trying to keep it down somehow.
Sandy is definitely coming into New York City and making a huge mess.
This was our home, you know? I mean, I'm sorry.
The statistics are awesome. Almost 200 dead. An estimated $50 billion worth of damage, and more than 8 million people without power. This is the story of a tragic and never to be forgotten 24 hours in the life of Superstorm Sandy. It's dawn, on the day that Superstorm Sandy is poised to strike. 90 miles off the coast of North Carolina, she claims one of her first American victims.
Altitude.
Roger, stand by.
The U.S. Coast Guard braves storm force winds to save the desperate crew of an historic tall ship that sunk in 18-foot waves.
Survivors getting out of the basket.
They pulled 15 people from the water, but one woman is unresponsive. Resuscitation attempts fail. 42-year-old Claudine Christian has a unique and tragic distinction in the history of Superstorm Sandy that day.
She was the first American life to be taken by Hurricane Sandy. Such a little spark and firecracker in life. Just couldn't believe she was just taken. And
Claudine had been a crew member on the three-masted sailing ship, HMS Bounty.
Swimmers at basket, hold.
The ship's captain, Robin Walbridge, was missing at sea. The search for the captain would later be abandoned. With Sandy powering towards land, scientists at NOAA's National Hurricane Center are deeply concerned.
Things have really changed from a couple days ago.
Hurricane Sandy now has maintained its strength. The hope that this system would steer out to sea is gone. Now the fact that it looks like it will hit the northeast, still do not know the exact location of where the storm will hit.
If this forecast is right, this is going to spell It's going to be a major disaster in the Northeast. You know, we're talking about a multi-billion-dollar storm and maybe a record-setting event.
We really should start to prepare for something that could be a very devastating event.
Hard reality is that even if we do everything within our power to prepare, we can't stop the storm.
I've been hearing about evacuate for since we've been here.
Those who choose to stay are going to find themselves in this situation. If they do get in trouble, we will not go for them.
We'll ride it out. We'll ride it out like we ride all of them out, you know?
Yeah, we're not looking forward to it. Getting too old for this.
We have never left the house or evacuated in the past. We are staying.
The storm should be felt as far away as Michigan and parts of Ohio. This is an unprecedented situation, and everyone should really be taking heed.
Early afternoon, the outlying winds reach the heart of New York City. Then the storm hits a Long Island suburban street.
This is the apocalypse.
Oh!
I heard the kids downstairs joking around, kidding around, playing.
Oh my God!
Oh my God! Shit! Our tree!
Yeah.
What? Our tree! Oh! Dad!
It hit your car! Oh my God! Oh my God!
It hit my car!
Oh, the car!
They reached a point in time where I realized it wasn't joking. They were screaming something was going on.
I wasn't expecting anything really. Just thought that the storm wasn't even going to be that big of a deal. I was just deciding to film a video out my window, maybe send it to my friend. And then I just captured something crazy on film.
Oh my God! I got that all on film!
I was on the computer and I heard him. And I looked out the window to see the tree falling. And I screamed first because the tree was falling, and then I realized it was about to hit my car. The wind didn't look that bad, but it snapped like a twig.
Oh my God!
What happened?
The car got crushed!
I felt like I was in like a horror movie watching all these trees falling around my house, because when it's your home turf, like when it's your house seeing it happen, it's just, you're in a state of shock.
The danger here are trees falling, and they have happened in the past where they kill people. It's eerie because it's almost like silence until it makes contact with whatever it's hitting. Then you just hear like an unmistakable crushing of metal.
I was scared throughout the whole entire night. It was horrible. Felt like I was in a horror movie.
Let's get away from it.
There's a fire. There's a fire, Dad. There's a fire, Dad.
Oh my God.
There ain't nothing I can do about that.
Oh my God.
Trees were crashing down everywhere. But it wasn't just wind causing the problem. The storm was so slow moving that it lingered over the Northeast, saturating the ground below.
We also had a lot of rain right before that system came. So that was like the setup for losing a lot of trees. You soften the ground, it gets moist, you lose a lot of trees.
Late afternoon on the coast of New Jersey, waves are growing by the minute.
Oh my gosh!
Waiting for the hurricane to hit is storm chaser Jeff Petrowski.
Winds are gusting to 85 miles an hour off the coast now. Just had a wind report that says south of Boston, the cement's going to put. Winds gusting to 89 miles an hour.
Other storm chasers are also descending on what promises to be an epic event.
Here at the north shore of Long Island. You can see the flooding behind me. In fact, I'm up to my knees in water right now. Now this is the first high tide and the surge isn't all that big. The secondary high tide, which comes later on tonight when the surge is much higher, this whole area is likely to flood out far more.
The hurricane is now approaching the coastline. It's only gonna get worse from here.
With night falling, Jeff is getting ready for the storm surge.
Look at the water! Look at the storm surge on the Garden State Parkway! Looks like a dam is broke. I mean, it is pouring across the garden. This is bad.
The water was wreaking havoc on homes in Brooklyn.
Flooded out.
There's disinfection everywhere.
The water was covering the street completely. And you couldn't see the road anymore. After a while, we began to see water literally start flowing back down the steps to the basement door where we were. And then suddenly, out of the blues, you know, the door broke open.
Oh my God! Oh my God! The door break open!
This is the river, a river or even the ocean was gushing in.
The door just break open!
And at that point, even I got scared.
Oh my God!
This was as though somebody had sort of diverted the sea to the house. It's moving faster than you can think or faster than you can act.
Should we try to close it? No, but we didn't try to close it.
This water just came in like if it was the ocean coming into the with so much force.
Sound you careful. Go, go, go. You can't let Shayla do that. We need to try to keep it out somehow.
Suddenly, the power went, and that was a very, very scary moment.
Power was failing all over the region, but it was about to get worse because seawater and electricity are not a good mix. In this one spectacular flash, a Con Edison substation blows up, cutting power to almost 1 million New York City homes. Local resident John Matauzzi captures the explosion on video.
I started walking down to the water. The flood was starting to come up. It was about 2 feet by then. This area right here was like a crazy wind tunnel. It felt like 100 mile per hour gusts. I mean, you had little girls that were like grabbing on the trees like this, holding on for their life. It got pretty dangerous over here because there was these metal sheets that must have weighed like 30 pounds that were just woof, 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 flipping through the air. And all of a sudden my camera just lit up. Then we get another huge flash, a blue blast. I mean, it looked like something out of a sci-fi movie. And everyone started screaming. Some were just kind of like, oh. Sense that New Yorkers have been feeling, you felt it. When Manhattan went out, then the New World Trade was actually one of the only things that was lit. So it looked really unreal, because half of Brooklyn Bridge was out, all of Manhattan, and then this big tower was glowing. And eventually that went out. And throughout the night, you'd see these blue explosions in the distance. Which became extremely spooky. It looked like something out of, you know, Independence Day.
Nightfall. Superstorm Sandy sends millions of New Yorkers back to the Dark Ages. Communications are breaking down, and the emergency services are stretched to the limit. 911 is inundated with almost 20,000 calls an hour. That's about 300 calls a minute, 5 every second. With phone lines down, Sandy's victims turn in desperation to social media like Twitter. Hundreds of tweets per minute are now arriving at the New York Fire Department's headquarters. Social media manager Emily Rahimi is trying to help.
I would say about 8 o'clock to 10 o'clock, I started to see a lot more panicked tweets, which I've never experienced on Twitter before. There were a lot of people who were losing phone service that were not able to get through to 911, who were tweeting in emergency calls. I was getting a sense of the panic definitely through the words that they were using, the speed in which they were tweeting. I would get, you know, 4 tweets within a couple seconds of each other from the same person.
Among the many tweets was a dramatic plea for help. A woman fears for the safety of her parents trapped by the floods.
This woman tweeted very early in the evening that her parents were trapped in their home on Staten Island. And I told them that I was contacting dispatchers, but for them to also try contacting 911.
Staten Island was particularly hard hit by Sandy. Many of New York's fatalities occurred on this tiny island. Emily tries to save lives by using Twitter to send out vital advice.
That night, it was mainly just trying to communicate to the people that if their house is starting to fill up with water, that definitely meant that outside it was even worse. It was moving extremely quickly. It was moving as if it was a river. It was carrying a lot of debris. So being outside your house in that situation without a rescuer there who could help you was probably worse than actually being in your house. This storm was definitely a 21st century storm. And this is really, I think, the first one that has used social media to call for help.
Of the emergency calls made that night, emergency medical services responded to almost 6,000. But they're not the only ones pushed to the limit. Hospitals are also overwhelmed. On the Lower East Side, NYU Hospital has lost power and is evacuating over 200 critical patients. For these patients, this nightmare has become a matter of life or death. Manhattan is in a medical crisis.
Breaking news from Hurricane Sandy. CNN's Chris Welsh is live now in Lower Manhattan. The situation that's most pressing may well be what's happening at NYU University Hospital. What is going on down there in terms of the patients?
That's where they are now moving about 200 patients to various hospitals in the area because of these waters.
You would never think this was happening in New York. So the best way to deal with now is just not panic. I mean, the NYPD is doing all they can. They have a lot of patrol cars going on every single block. People just gotta stay civil.
In New Jersey, Abby Wellington and Stephen Olofsson face a medical emergency of their own. There's no power in their house. The roads are all blocked. Abby is pregnant. She doesn't realize she's about to give birth.
As the hurricane was starting, I was only days from my due date, so I was nervous.
We had lost our power. We had no heat, but it was probably around 9:30. We got in bed and
I felt a little bit of pain, but nothing. It didn't feel like the contractions I felt last time. It came again maybe 8 or 10 minutes later. Then it seemed, okay, maybe something's starting.
Unable to reach a hospital, their only recourse is to reach out for help from their neighbor, Jan.
I get a text, come, the baby's coming.
Abby is terrified at the prospect of delivering her baby without medical assistance.
So it was still scary and it was very dark. We had no power. There were just a couple candles on in the bathroom and I felt something. And we realized it was the bag of water and that the head was coming and that there wasn't actually anything wrong. It was just, I really was about to have the baby in half hour.
The baby is well on its way. Stephen and Jan improvise as they frantically search the house for anything that might help. They even find use for potato chip clips, an emergency measure to clamp off the umbilical cord. Within the hour, Abby gives birth by candlelight on her bathroom floor. Against all the odds, Abby's delivery goes smoothly, but it could have been a very different story.
This storm caused a lot of damage. A lot of people died. We're very lucky.
Superstorm Sandy was not stopping for anyone, not even baby Henley. A huge test for New York's emergency services comes at around 11 p.m. In Queens, downed power lines spark a devastating fire that tears through the neighborhood of Breezy Point. a monster storm, almost 1,000 miles wide.
This is going to be a big and powerful storm.
With the destructive power of an atomic bomb. A natural disaster of extraordinary force strikes the northeast coast of the United States.
Don't mess with Mother Nature.
Never seen anything like this.
What's going on? I don't know what's going on. It's a hurricane.
You would never think this was happening in New York.
50 homes already have burned to the ground.
This is unbelievable, man.
I've never witnessed anything like this.
Oh, my God!
Unbelievable. I'm sorry.
Hey, Heather, it's Michelle. Hi. I don't know. I can't even, I don't even know what to say. I'm just happy that we're alive. We're all just sort of, there's no power, there's no service, there's no phones. It's like a scene out of some end of the world movie.
The people on the East Coast wake to Sandy's aftermath. This was a storm of almost unimaginable power. Sandy's impact was felt along the coastline from Florida to Massachusetts before she made landfall. Then it blew an ocean into the heart of New York City.
Oh my God!
With such devastating power, she grows to a superstorm.
Uh-oh.
Terrifying millions of people.
Try to keep it out somehow.
Sandy is definitely coming into New York City and making a huge mess.
This was our home, you know? I mean, I'm sorry.
The statistics are awesome. Almost 200 dead. An estimated $50 billion worth of damage, and more than 8 million people without power. This is the story of a tragic and never to be forgotten 24 hours in the life of Superstorm Sandy. It's dawn, on the day that Superstorm Sandy is poised to strike. 90 miles off the coast of North Carolina, she claims one of her first American victims.
Altitude.
Roger, stand by.
The U.S. Coast Guard braves storm force winds to save the desperate crew of an historic tall ship that sunk in 18-foot waves.
Survivors getting out of the basket.
They pulled 15 people from the water, but one woman is unresponsive. Resuscitation attempts fail. 42-year-old Claudine Christian has a unique and tragic distinction in the history of Superstorm Sandy that day.
She was the first American life to be taken by Hurricane Sandy. Such a little spark and firecracker in life. Just couldn't believe she was just taken. And
Claudine had been a crew member on the three-masted sailing ship, HMS Bounty.
Swimmers at basket, hold.
The ship's captain, Robin Walbridge, was missing at sea. The search for the captain would later be abandoned. With Sandy powering towards land, scientists at NOAA's National Hurricane Center are deeply concerned.
Things have really changed from a couple days ago.
Hurricane Sandy now has maintained its strength. The hope that this system would steer out to sea is gone. Now the fact that it looks like it will hit the northeast, still do not know the exact location of where the storm will hit.
If this forecast is right, this is going to spell It's going to be a major disaster in the Northeast. You know, we're talking about a multi-billion-dollar storm and maybe a record-setting event.
We really should start to prepare for something that could be a very devastating event.
Hard reality is that even if we do everything within our power to prepare, we can't stop the storm.
I've been hearing about evacuate since we've been here.
Those who choose to stay are going to find themselves in this situation. If they do get in trouble, we will not go for them.
We'll ride it out. We'll ride it out like we ride all of them out, you know?
Yeah, we're not looking forward to it. Getting too old for this.
We have never left the house or evacuated in the past. We are staying.
The storm should be felt as far away as Michigan and parts of Ohio. This is an unprecedented situation, and everyone should really be taking heed.
Early afternoon, the outlying winds reach the heart of New York City. Then the storm hits a Long Island suburban street.
This is the apocalypse.
Oh!
I heard the kids downstairs joking around, kidding around, playing.
God!
Oh my God! Shit! Our tree!
Yeah.
What? Our tree! Oh.
Dad! It hit your car! Oh my God! Oh my God!
It hit my car!
Oh, my car!
They reached a point in time where I realized it wasn't joking. They were screaming something was going on.
I wasn't expecting anything really. Just thought that the storm wasn't even going to be that big of a deal. I was just deciding to film a video out my window, maybe send it to my friend. And then I just captured something crazy on film.
Oh my God! Oh my God, that all on film!
I was on the computer and I heard him and I looked out the window to see the tree falling. And I screamed first because the tree was falling. And then I realized it was about to hit my car. The wind didn't look that bad, but it snapped like a twig.
Oh my God!
What happened? Their car got crushed!
I felt like I was in like a horror movie watching all these trees falling around my house, because when it's your home turf, like when it's your house seeing it happen, it's just, you're in a state of shock.
The danger here are trees falling, and they have happened in the past where they kill people. It's eerie, because it's almost like silence until it makes contact with whatever it's hitting. Then you just hear like, you know, like an unmistakable crushing of metal.
I was scared throughout the whole entire night. It was horrible. Felt like I was in a horror movie.
Let's get away from this.
There's a fire. There's a fire, Dad. There's a fire, Dad.
Oh my God.
There ain't nothing I can do about that.
Oh my God.
Trees were crashing down everywhere. But it wasn't just wind causing the problem. The storm was so slow moving that it lingered over the Northeast, saturating the ground below.
We also had a lot of rain right before that system came. So that was like the setup for losing a lot of trees. You soften the ground, it gets moist, you lose a lot of trees.
Late afternoon on the coast of New Jersey, waves are growing by the minute. Waiting for the hurricane to hit is storm chaser Jeff Petrowski.
Winds are gusting to 85 miles an hour off the coast now. Just had a wind report that says south of Boston, just 2 minutes ago on the hood, winds gusting to 89 miles an hour.
Other storm chasers are also descending on what promises to be an epic event.
Sandy is really beginning to make itself felt here on the north shore of Long Island. You can see the flooding behind me. In fact, I'm up to my knees in water right now. Now this is the first high tide, and the surge isn't all that big. The secondary high tide, which comes later on tonight when the surge is much higher, this whole area is likely to flood out far more.
The hurricane is now approaching the coastline. It's only going to get worse from here.
With night falling, Jeff is getting ready for the storm surge.
Look at the water! Look at the storm surge on the Garden State Parkway! Looks like a dam is broke. I mean, it is pouring across the garden. This is bad.
The water was wreaking havoc on homes in Brooklyn.
Flooded out.
There's brushing everywhere.
The water was covering the street completely. And you couldn't see the road anymore. After a while, we're going to see water literally start flowing back down the steps to the basement door where we were. And then suddenly out of the blues, you know, the door broke open.
Oh my God! Oh my God! The door break open!
This is the river or even the ocean was gushing in.
The door just break open!
And at that point, even I got scared.
Oh my God!
This was as though somebody had sort of diverted the sea to the house. It's moving faster than you can think or faster than you can act.
Should we try to close it? No, but we didn't try to close it.
This water just came in like if it was the ocean coming into the, with so much force.
Sound you careful. Go, go, go. You can't let Shayla do that. We need to try to keep it out somehow.
Suddenly, the power went, and that was a very, very scary moment.
Power was failing all over the region, but it was about to get worse because seawater and electricity are not a good mix. In this one spectacular flash, a Con Edison substation blows up, cutting power to almost 1 million New York City homes. Local resident John Matauzzi captures the explosion on video.
I started walking down to the water. The flood was starting to come up. It was about 2 feet by then. This area right here was like a crazy wind tunnel. It felt like 100-mile-per-hour gusts. I mean, you had little girls that were like grabbing on the trees like this, holding on for their life. It got pretty dangerous over here because there was these metal sheets that must have weighed like 30 pounds that were just woof, 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 flipping through the air. And then all of a sudden my camera just lit up. Then we get another huge flash, a blue blast. I mean, it looked like something out of a sci-fi movie. And everyone started screaming. Some were just kind of like, oh. Sense that New Yorkers have been feeling, you felt it. When Manhattan went out, then the New World Trade was actually one of the only things that was lit. So it looked really unreal, because half of Brooklyn Bridge was out, all of Manhattan, and then this big tower was glowing. And eventually that went out. And throughout the night, you'd see these blue explosions in the distance. Which became extremely spooky. It looked like something out of, you know, Independence Day.
Nightfall. Superstorm Sandy sends millions of New Yorkers back to the Dark Ages. Communications are breaking down, and the emergency services are stretched to the limit. 911 is inundated with almost 20,000 calls an hour. That's about 300 calls a minute, 5 every second. With phone lines down, Sandy's victims turn in desperation to social media like Twitter. Hundreds of tweets per minute are now arriving at the New York Fire Department's headquarters. Social media manager Emily Rahimi is trying to help.
I would say about 8 o'clock to 10 o'clock, I started to see a lot more panicked tweets, which I've never experienced on Twitter before. There were a lot of people who were losing phone service that were not able to get through to 911, who were tweeting in emergency calls. I was getting a sense of the panic definitely through the words that they were using, the speed in which they were tweeting. I would get, you know, 4 tweets within a couple seconds of each other from the same person.
Among the many tweets was a dramatic plea for help. A woman fears for the safety of her parents trapped by the floods.
This woman tweeted very early in the evening that her parents were trapped in their home on Staten Island. And I told them that I was contacting dispatchers, but for them to also try contacting 911.
Staten Island was particularly hard hit by Sandy. Many of New York's fatalities occurred on this tiny island. Emily tries to save lives by using Twitter to send out vital advice.
That night, it was mainly just trying to communicate to the people that if their house is starting to fill up with water, that definitely meant that outside it was even worse. It was moving extremely quickly. It was moving as if it was a river. It was carrying a lot of debris. So being outside your house in that situation without a rescuer there who could help you was probably worse than actually being in your house. This storm was definitely a 21st century storm. And this is really, I think, the first one that has used social media to call for help.
Of the emergency calls made that night, emergency medical services responded to almost 6,000. But they're not the only ones pushed to the limit. Hospitals are also overwhelmed. On the Lower East Side, NYU Hospital has lost power and is evacuating over 200 critical patients. For these patients, this nightmare has become a matter of life or death. Manhattan is in a medical crisis.
Breaking news from Hurricane Sandy. CNN's Chris Welsh is live now in Lower Manhattan. The situation that's most pressing may well be what's happening at NYU University Hospital. What is going on down there in terms of the patients?
That's where they are now moving about 200 patients to various hospitals in the area because of these waters.
You would never think this was happening in New York. So the best way to deal with now is just not panic. I mean, the NYPD is doing all they can. They have a lot of patrol cars going on every single block. People just gotta stay civil.
In New Jersey, Abby Wellington and Stephen Olofsson face a medical emergency of their own. There's no power in their house. The roads are all blocked. Abby is pregnant. She doesn't realize she's about to give birth.
As the hurricane was starting, I was only days from my due date, so I was nervous.
We had lost our power. We had no heat, but it was probably around 9:30. We got in bed and
I felt a little bit of pain, but nothing. It didn't feel like the contractions I felt last time. It came again maybe 8 or 10 minutes later. Then it seemed, okay, maybe something's starting.
Unable to reach a hospital, their only recourse is to reach out for help from their neighbor, Jan.
I get a text, come, the baby's coming.
Abby is terrified at the prospect of delivering her baby without medical assistance.
So it was still scary and it was very dark. We had no power. There were just a couple candles on in the bathroom and I felt something. And we realized it was the bag of water and that the head was coming and that there wasn't actually anything wrong. It was just, I really was about to have the baby in half hour.
The baby is well on its way. Stephen and Jan improvise as they frantically search the house for anything that might help. They even find use for potato chip clips, an emergency measure to clamp off the umbilical cord. Within the hour, Abby gives birth by candlelight on her bathroom floor. Against all the odds, Abby's delivery goes smoothly, but it could have been a very different story.
This storm caused a lot of damage. A lot of people died. We're very lucky.
Superstorm Sandy was not stopping for anyone, not even baby Henley. A huge test for New York's emergency services comes at around 11 p.m. In Queens, downed power lines spark a devastating fire that tears through the neighborhood of Breezy Point.
The ingredients came together for it to have a high impact.
This really was a superstorm. I mean, you have the massive storm surge, the winds, power lines down, flooding rains, and believe it or not, in October, some places in West Virginia, 36 inches of snow, 3 feet of snow. And far away in the Great Lakes, 1,000 miles away, there were surfers riding 20-foot waves. Sandy was that massive. The entire east coast of the United States, as far back as Chicago and the Great Lakes, impacted by this storm.
Extreme weather is affecting every part of the globe. In 2012, Russian agriculture suffers its second drought in 2 years. Great Britain is deluged by record-breaking summer rainfall. And Venice continues to flirt with the sea. In the US, destructive tornadoes are rampant. And more than 9 million acres burn in wildfires sparked by tinderbox conditions. Climate change appears to be real. Average temperatures have risen more than 1 degree over the past 100 years. But can extreme weather events like Superstorm Sandy be linked directly to a changing climate?
We're still trying to understand the effects of climate change, and whether or not we'll see more storms like Sandy is still unknown.
Coming from a scientist background, we have to really look at it objectively. If you start saying that the rare event is becoming the common event, that to me is good evidence for something is changing. Now, that needs to be quantitatively done, not done in an ad hoc nature. If someone can show that, then I'm on board with believing more of the change aspects.
Global warming means that there's more energy in our atmosphere, there's more energy in our oceans, and this energy is seen in terms of storms. And that energy means we get more extremes. Unseasonal weather, our seasons are changing. More hurricanes, heavier winds, more tropical storms. And it's this pattern of events that people are going to have to get used to over the coming decades and centuries.
9 days after Sandy, there is further bad weather for New Yorkers. An unwelcome nor'easter leaves tens of thousands without power in freezing temperatures. Is extreme weather something we all should simply get used to?
Virtually every expert knows that humans are warming the planet. These same experts tell us that storms like Sandy are going to become more common in the future, combined with rising sea levels, which are absolutely going to happen. Those sea levels are going to rise for centuries.
If the sea levels are rising, what do? You move up the hill. And I think the way forward is to look at how you relocate, how you redesign towns and cities for the next 2 or 3 centuries.
Certainly preparation for these events is necessary and mandatory, and not, you know, after they happen, but before they happen.
Not all scientists agree on the causes of climate change. But one thing seems clear. Hurricanes like Sandy will visit again. Has some sort of tipping point been reached? We all may learn the answer much sooner than we would like.
Hi. I don't know. I don't even know what to say. I'm just happy that we're alive. We're all just sort of, there's no power, there's no service, there's no phone. It's like a scene out of some end of the world movie. And there's no exaggeration there. I don't even know how, words can't describe it. The boardwalk is gone, but we're okay. We're just making fires at night in the street and cooking communally and trying to stay together and be safe and keep the block safe, and that's it. I don't think people understand exactly what happened in our neighborhood.